Welcome, friends, to this afternoon session of our first day of the two-day event in Dubai. Very happy to see you all again. I'll be answering some questions now. Somebody will read out the question that has been sent. Then I will read it again to understand it better. And I'll attempt an answer.
Is it an absolute must to be a vegetarian to be enlightened? People like Rumi, Sri Mataji, David Hawkins all obtained it without being vegetarian.
The question is it an absolute must to be a vegetarian to be enlightened? People like Rumi, Sri Mataji, David Hawkins all obtained it without being vegetarian. Naturally, no food can affect our enlightenment. It doesn't mean that if you don't eat this food, you can't get enlightened, or that this food will give enlightenment. There was a Zen master from Japan. He said, the only way to enlightenment is if you eat a particular Japanese rice, and the whole secret of enlightenment is in that little grain of rice. I said, I like to get the shortcut to enlightenment. Actually visited his ashram in Japan and tasted that rice. I ate one, his second, third, no enlightenment came. I said, how can you say that this rice is containing enlightenment? I can understand that you are taking rice with a certain meaning given to it by you. That's a suggestion that you're making to your own self. And suggestions do work. That is true. If a suggestion is made that this alone will work, our mind is such it will accept that suggestion. And that is the power of the mind to accept suggestions. So, is it really necessary to have vegetarian food? Not necessary for enlightenment. But it is necessary if you want to have more rapid experience in meditation. And I'll explain to you why. Because our mind holds on the feeling that you should not kill somebody. It's a natural thing in us. When we kill somebody, something happens to our mind. What happens? We lose the power of concentration for a while. You can try it yourself. You have a book you are reading which requires your attention. Your normal reading pace for that particular book is one page per minute. Go and kill an animal and come back, in one page you won't cover that. Your power of concentrating your attention is diminished and takes time to recover. Which is true. If you kill a man, it takes even longer. If you kill a bird, little less than a, of the animal, much less than a man, but still some. If you eat a vegetable, it still has some effect, but the least. This is because in these forms of life, with these species, the effect on our mind is based upon the level of the developed consciousness in each of these. So where the development of consciousness is the least, like in vegetables, the effect on our consciousness is the least in concentrating our attention. Since what I'm talking of since morning is about the power of attention and concentration of attention, therefore, if you are on a vegetarian meal, it helps you to meditate better. And I had this discussion with His Holiness Dalai Lama. As it happened when Dalai Lama was exiled from Tibet because of Chinese occupation, he came to a place where I was the district deputy commissioner, district commissioner there, Dharamsala. It fell to my lot to take care of Dalai Lama. He was a young man at that time, younger than me, and he had two tutors with him who were teaching him how to meditate. He meditated 8 hours a day. He was not knowing Hindi or English, But he had a translator. In a few months, he picked up enough of this and some body language. We began to communicate with each other. And I had a Land Rover given to me by the government. And normally a chauffeur used to drive it, but when I took Dalai Lama, I took up the wheels. And we both loved to drive in the mountains near Dharamsala. And on the way, we would discuss meditation. He was not a vegetarian. So I told him that Buddha said, whom you follow, thou shalt not kill. How can you eat killed animals then? He said, I don't kill. The person who kills suffers the karma of killing. I only eat what is already killed. So therefore, I cannot be affected by that. We had a lot of argument on that basis, whether vegetarian diet helps or not. I said, you meditate so much in a day. Ultimate argument was, I said, there is nothing like the proof of the pudding lies in the eating. Nothing like experience. You have been meditating with meat and that kind of food. Try meditation for 1 month without meat. And he tried and became a vegetarian. He remained a vegetarian. And in Zurich, he fell sick on one of his visits. There they fed him some animals, beef soup or something. And he immediately reacted to that. I was then posted in Chandigarh, the capital, the chief secretary of the state. He came back to tell me that this is what happened. And I said, now your role, you have seen what enlightenment you can get. The compassion has come in you, love has come in you. Now you are a temporal and spiritual head in exile. So your temporal duties will continue with all your work that you are doing. Now recently, of course, he informed me that he has left his temporal duties completely and he's passed it on to some other politicians of Tibet. And he is now on spiritual work again. I'm giving an example. He practiced vegetarian food and got better results of meditation. So can you. So I'm not saying that the diet controls enlightenment. People have got enlightened up to certain points. There are certain levels of enlightenment. People who have had just an out-of-body experience, they say we are enlightened. People who have just seen light inside, they say we are enlightened because we have seen the light. People have seen colors inside, they say we are enlightened. I was a very curious person when I was young. I would never think that is enlightenment. I said enlightenment is to have no question left unanswered. If you still have questions, I don't think you are really enlightened. If all questions have been answered, then I can say you are enlightened. And that happens when you go beyond the mind. The mind does not rest with any answers you give. It will continually develop new questions from your answers. So that is why enlightenment, according to me, is going beyond the mind into what is called Parabrahma and Sajkhand, which are regions of spirituality alone, spirit alone, with no mind. So that is why I recommend, if you are serious about meditation, vegetarian diet will be good for you.
You spoke about miracles, but you also spoke about predetermined destiny. Are miracles also pre-written, or do they happen because of good karma of meeting a perfect living master?
You spoke about miracles, but you also spoke about predetermined destiny. Are miracles also pre-written, or do they happen because of good karma or meeting a perfect living master? This is a very interesting question. I'll give you the simple answer. Our destiny in this life is predestined. We don't know it. We don't know what is predestined. We decide what to do. How can you call it predestined? It's just a philosophy that somewhere else it is pre-written, but in our daily life it's not pre-written. It's only when you go to the higher planes where you can read pre-written, or you meet a Bhatra like I did, who can tell you something before you have thought of it, that you can feel something is pre-written. Otherwise, nothing is pre-written. Therefore, miracles, of course, are not part of our normal destiny at all. When you go to the astral plane, you find that what you thought was your decision making here was already pre-written. You didn't know about it. And therefore, you thought you were making a decision here. Knowledge of pre-written only comes when you can see that the future was already there, which you can read. Similarly, a miracle happens here. Miracle was predestined, but it did not fit in with our idea of how destiny will move. It looked a miracle. Then you ask for divine intervention at that level. A master, a guru who has access to the higher plane, intervenes and says, this will not happen. And even what you see pre-written is changed. Then that means that part was not pre-written. Then you go to the next higher plane, the causal plane, and you find a master will intervene and change it, pre-written there. Okay, then you say, let's have an intervention there, in the causal plane, where destinies can be changed. And then you say, I'm changing my destiny. Then you go higher up from where everything originated. It was also pre-written. So it depends, when you say, is it pre-written, depends on where it is pre-written. It's not one level of awareness here. We are talking of several levels of awareness. And what looks like pre-written here, and we think it is changed by miracle, the miracle is pre-written at a higher level. A miracle at that level is pre-written at a higher level. Eventually at the top you find everything was completely pre-written, including miracles.
What is the point of existence? Why did God even bother, and why is there so much of suffering?
What is the point of existence? Why did God even bother, and why is there so much suffering? A good question. Many people have asked me this question. What's the purpose of existence? Well, why do we go see movies? What's the purpose of seeing a movie? Why are we going to movies? Why do we go and see a play? What's the purpose? To entertain ourselves, to see a nice adventure. Why do we go on vacation? For adventure. That's exactly the purpose of this existence. We don't belong here. This is not our place. We came merely for entertainment and adventure. Know the purpose. The existence was merely to have a different experience than we have in our true home. In a true home is totality of consciousness. Imagine, in our true home there is a thing called love. Love is not a lover, nor is love a beloved. Love is love. Love becomes a lover and beloved when you have a creation of more than one. The many were created in our true home. The many souls were created to make that which was nature of our true home becomes an experience. All experience is generated because of the nature of consciousness. If we were not conscious, if consciousness was not our root, we could have no good explanation. But if consciousness is our root, consciousness does not exist without being conscious of something. And whatever it becomes conscious of, with its unlimited power, becomes creation. What we have done is to have a series of creations, levels of creation. And each level is more interesting than the other, more diversified, more different. And we have gone on to this. This is not the only universe. The experiments in consciousness go to so many universes, accessible to you, just flying at a different level. You can go and see other universes, even physical universes existing, which we cannot access here, but you can access from there. Why all this? For adventure, for experience, for new experience. Consciousness needs experience all the time. That is why the creator and creation are both permanent. It's not that creation did not take place, creator sat alone. He wouldn't be called creator, he wouldn't be called conscious. This is a continuous story. in time, in terms of time and space where we are living now, it's a continuous story all the time. That is why what we have done is to make each experience as real as possible. The idea of having different levels of consciousness was not to create shadows, it was to create reality. As real as possible. Do you know, we go to see a movie, do we forget that it's just a movie? I see people crying in the movie. I myself take out my handkerchief. The sad scene comes. I never cry in real life, I cry in movies. My children sometimes come with me, they carry extra handkerchief for me for my tears, only in a movie. So many of us, a scary movie comes, we jump in our seats. Do we forget it's just a shadow? It's not even real, there are no people there. Don't we realize it's all predetermined? Don't we know that behind us is a projector carrying a film made much earlier, loaded much earlier, the story is written much earlier, and we are looking at it, now what will happen next? Now what will happen next? We are creating the now in it. How is that possible? An answer to this question was given by a Greek philosopher named Socrates. And Socrates described that the world of ideas is more real than this world. And that is why this world is a copy, and we are acting in order to have an experience of the ideas created in the higher world. If you study philosophy carefully, metaphysics carefully, you'll find concepts all arise in the causal plane, in the mental plane. The ideas drawn from concepts come in the astral plane through imagination. And the implementation of those ideas in physical forms takes place here, each working in unison with each other as cause and effect. Plato, disciple of Socrates, gives an example how the world of ideas is more real. He takes the example of a chair. We are all sitting on a chair. A few thousand years ago, there was no chair on this planet. We all sat on the ground. How did a chair come? How did the first chair come? Plato explains that the first chair came because of a concept. Do we have to sit so low? Can't we sit higher? That's all. That was not a chair. Merely concept that you can sit more comfortably if you're a little higher. Then the idea came, yeah, we can build something that can make a chair. So a chair was made which was higher than the ground, so we could sit on it. Only one chair, the idea of one chair has created millions and billions of chairs today. All different. One idea, billions of chairs. Therefore, Plato says, everything that's been created here, just an example, is all created from ideas that come from there, which are more real. Now come to the disciple of Plato, Aristotle. He discusses the role of drama. Movies were not there at his time. So he called it a drama. He says, why do we go and see a drama? A question that will also answer, why are we here in existence? Why do we go and see a drama? Because in drama, we forget it's a drama. We take it as real. He called it a willing suspension of disbelief. In Greek, he's written, the English translation would be that we go to a movie or a drama and willingly suspend our disbelief. We don't want to say it's unreal, we want to say it's real. And he explains, why do we do that? Because our life has so many emotions in it. We are built up with emotions. And it's a purgation of excess of emotions that takes place when we identify with the characters in the movie. Very good explanation. He gave same explanation is why we take movies to be real. We don't look back and say the projector is just projecting and pre-recorded, pre-written movie. We say it's happening now. We create a reality for that purpose. Consciousness is not emotions, but emotions have arisen from consciousness. And they play a very vital role in the physical plane. And that is why when these levels of experiences are created, they are created as real as possible. What are the elements that have created reality? First, lock you out of other levels of experience while you are here. Therefore, this looks like the only experience. only reality. That's wonderful. We go to sleep at night, we lose this reality. The dream is the only reality while we are dreaming. Wake up, dream was not real, this is real. We go to astral plane, that was real, physical was not real. We go to causal plane, only that is real. Both others were just made up, they were like dreams. That's the experience we get. Only one reality at one time. Everybody who has had ascent into higher levels of consciousness has gone through one reality after another reality, never two realities together. Supposing you mix up two realities, supposing you are having a dream and also awake, is not called a dream. That will be something like you're imagining something in daytime. Reality will be this one. Reality is only one, except at one point, and that is our true home. In our true home, where all the realities have been created, they are not created somewhere outside, all created within that true home, where if you have access to that, to totality of consciousness, there is nothing outside of it. There you experience all the realities, all created by the method of illusion, which looks completely both real and illusion at the same time from the top. That is why perfect living masters, when they come in our midst and talk to us, they are not talking from what they experienced long ago in their meditation. They are not explaining what they read in the books. They can talk to you directly of every level because they are conscious and aware of every level at all times, 24/7. That's the value of going to the top. And that is why perfect living masters say, if you are seekers of the ultimate, that's where we will take you. A perfect living master makes his disciple exactly like himself, not less than that. He does not make you a better person. There are thousands of people who can make you better persons. A perfect living master makes you exactly like yourself. My master used to give example. There is a philosopher's stone. A philosopher's stone, if it touches iron, it makes it into gold. But a perfect living master is a philosopher's stone, when it touches iron, it makes it into philosopher's stone. Makes it like himself. Giving that power, that experience, it is beyond experience. Experience is all in time. Don't forget, it's a state of being that you discover after experiences end with the mind. And that is the state of being which is with you at all times. Perfect living masters walk amongst us like ordinary human beings. And we can't even imagine that they are at all realities at the same time. Therefore, they can talk with great authority. I was impressed reading the Bible. And when Jesus Christ gives his sermon on the mount, at the end, the Bible says, after he spoke, there was a hush upon the multitude. For he spake like one with authority and not like the scribes, not like the learned people. Do you know in the talks, in Jesus Christ's sermons, in master's talks, in perfectly master's talks, you will never hear maybes, perhapses, but professors will talk all the time of maybes and perhapses. There is no maybe or perhaps in their talk because they don't talk from speculation or surmising, they talk from direct experience. So that's a very big difference. The reason why we are existing here is consciousness needs experience of various kinds. We came for that experience. We are enjoying it. We made arrangement before we came here that if we get caught because of the single reality we are experiencing, we should be able to get out. Arrangement we made ourselves was when we are ready to go back. We'll get tired of this experience. We'll say, this is not our home. These thoughts will come to us pre-written right from the beginning. And those thoughts will bring another human being like ourselves coming as a friend. From friend he finds his love is different. And from his love, he'll pull us back to the same place our own arrangement worked out.
If Master firmly states his will, is it reassured?
If Master firmly
states his will,
Master firmly states his will.
Is it reassured?
Is it reassured?
Yes.
Absolutely. Okay, one more question.
This one is actually three questions in Punjabi. So we requested somebody to translate it into English for us. Is God in a physical form or non-physical form? Kabir Sahib gave Guru Nanak Ji a two-letter mantra according to the Bani. Do akshar ka bhed bataya, soi guru pura kahaye. Which is that two-letter mantra? And according to Kabir Sagar, the third word is Sar Shabd. Is it possible to get complete nirvana by using this word?
It's good the last question is many questions. Is God in physical form or in non-physical form? That's the first question.
Yes.
There's a, what would you expect would be the physical form of God? If we were to imagine that let us want to see God in physical form, what form would you like him to see? Because different cultures have seen God in many forms. The Hindus have believed that God manifests in the nature. He makes a cow a holy cow, gives some sanctity to a cow, gives sanctity to a bull if he's Nandi. Similarly, he gives sanctity to many forms of life. And then it also gives sanctity to people who can give nice discourses on spirituality, gives sanctity to books which describe higher things. Sanctity is given to the Vedas, which Vedvyas merely compiled for guidance into four parts, dealing with spiritual part, meaning economic part, worldly life, customs. He just divided them, but we give great credence to that. We give the sanctity to it. But we don't see God there, because God, we define, we all define what God is. Nobody has seen him. Let me tell you, my experience, nobody can see God. If one can see God, that is not God, because then you are separate from God. Nothing is separate from totality, which is the ultimate creator. If the definition of God is the ultimate creative power, nothing is outside of it. None of us, none of the planets, none of these universes, they're all part of God. God is in everything. Therefore, if somebody says, I am seeing God, that means he's separate from God, that is not God. He's incomplete. God is complete. Therefore, no one can see God. What can one do? One can merge in God and become God. That's possible. That's precisely what happens. The spiritual path is meant for that. The highest spiritual path is meant not to see God, but be God. Because you cannot be separated from God. Nothing can be separated. Otherwise, if you want to see God, you can see in each one person here. We are all manifestations of God. Every tree that grows is a manifestation of God. Every living thing is manifestation of God. Every non-living thing is manifestation of God. Every stone, every brick is manifestation of God. We are seeing God in everything. Why is that? Because if the nature of God is totality of consciousness, which is the definition we have given, we can give any definition. People have given different definitions. Supposing we give this definition, which appeals more to a rational mind today, that he is totality of consciousness. That means wherever consciousness exists, God is existing. We as human beings are all conscious beings, therefore we are manifestations of God. two types of consciousness is there, active consciousness and passive consciousness. Active consciousness is where you are the perceiver of God's work. You are the perceiver of what God has created around you, other human beings, nature, the planets, the universes. You can see those universes outside of yourself. That's the work of God you are observing from within as what? As soul. Then what is soul? Soul is not separate from God. The separation is only a drama. The separation of soul from the totality is only for experience. It has never been separated. Somebody said, how can you explain that? I took a glass of water. I'm going to explain with this glass of water the separation of soul from God. This glass of water is total glass of water. All water. One glass of water. But there are also drops of water in it. How many drops are there? I can make it 1 million drops, small size. I can make it 1 trillion drops, small size. I can keep on making any number of drops in the same glass. I can also make them very few drops, making them bigger. That's precisely the nature of our soul. Soul is not separated from God. It's a drop in God. And this thing bothered me when I was young, because somebody defined to me that we are drops from an ocean. We got lost, separated from the ocean. And now we are roaming around and struggling hard through meditation and spiritual disciplines to go back and merge in the ocean. That's how the spiritual path described to me. And I thought to myself, if we are drops, little drops, sun shines on us, we are bright, we make rainbows on ourselves, we have a great life, we have a personality. What are they telling? Struggle hard to go and merge in an ocean. Ocean doesn't care for one more drop, we lose everything by merging. Is this the spiritual path? When I was told this is the spiritual path, I said I'll never follow it. But I was wrong. They were wrong too. The truth was that drop never left the ocean. The drop only shrunk its awareness to that of a drop and became several drops in the same total. And the spiritual path is not going anywhere to find something, is to expand your awareness to totality of clubs. That's all. So that is why the soul itself is totality of God, shrunk to the size of an individuation form, and is watching this. It's more appropriate to call the soul as a point of view of God. That's one way of saying it, that you can have a point of view. You can see this stage from this side, from this side, from this side, from the top, from bottom, the different points of view from where you can see. If you can see it from a trillion points of view, if you can see from unlimited points of view, those points of view are our souls, and the totality which is seeing is God. So that is why the definition of God can be made in many ways, but the best is to actually go to our true home. The true home, which is the home where God resides, and you will find you are never separated from it. The whole drama was created in our true home. I surprised some people in the United States when I first went, and they said, why did we leave our home to come and worry here? And I said, we never left. Said, how can that be? Then why are we struggling so hard? We are struggling because we think we have left. We haven't left, we have left the awareness of it. And the whole spiritual path is to expand your awareness to totality. Now when I said you can be trillion drops in this glass, you can be fewer glasses, the drops will become bigger. Same thing happens when we enlarge our awareness by going to different levels of consciousness. We are merely enlarging our awareness, able to see more, able to experience more, ultimately experience the total. So this is the real nature of this. Is there a good definition of God? I read in the Bible. Good definition, which I liked, in John's Gospel. Opening verses. It says, The Bible says in John's Gospel, in the first verse, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. How could you be so clear? The Word was God. Not Bible. Now Rig Veda, in India, Rig Veda says, originally there was the Nad, the sound, and that was the creator and the creative power. It's a translation of the same words. Same thing has been said in many other religions. The word in the Gurbani, Guru Granth Sahib, it says very clearly that it's the Shabd that created this thing. Now we are beginning to think that the Bani means the Gurbani, the book, the Guru Granth Sahib. But Guru Granth Sahib says something different. It says, Bani Vaji Chon Jogui Chacho Sach Sunai. The book was compiled by 5th Patshahi, Guru Arjan Dev, and there was no Guru Granth Sahib before that. So, but the Bani they're talking of, the very Guru we are accepting, is saying that the Bani is talking of was in all the 4 yugas. Same thing about the word. Why is the word Bani or Shabd or word being used or Nad? What's the relevance of sound or word that can be heard or spoken? Why is everybody, every religion says that? That's an amazing thing which I found the coincidence that all religions are talking of some sound or word that can be heard. Anything that's audible is being explained as God. There's a secret to that. The secret is that God being conscious power creates experiences in different forms right up to our human experience. But in human experience, our consciousness sits in the center of the head behind eyes, third eye center, and consciousness there can be heard. It's audible. Not everywhere, but when it comes down, the same creative power, the same soul, there is a radiance of sound and light coming from the center of our own self, which can be heard. That is, our description is about the word that can be heard within ourselves. Everything is created from there. Gurbani says repeatedly about that everything was created from there. Similarly, if we can hear something, it's been described as sound or word or spoken word or unspoken word, no matter what. We are continuously talking of something that is audible and represents our own self. The sound of the self is inside each one of us. Not only is it in each one of us, it has a strange melody, a melodious ring to it, almost like the ringing of a bell. It was not a bad idea to put the bells in the belfries of the churches or ring temple bells and so on. Everywhere sound is being used in all religious places, because the significance of the sound was that you can actually hear the sound of the self within your true meditation. I was talking of repetition of words and the use of that, but I have tried many methods. I have been to every type of yogi, every type of Swami, for the simple reason that when I was initiated by my master, great master, he said at the time of initiation that what he is sharing with us, he got from his master, Baba Jamal Singh. It worked for him, and he said, I hope it works for you. If it does not, that's what he said, if it does not, you are free to go and choose anything else that is better than what I am giving you. I took it very seriously. So I tried everything I could. I got converted to Islam to try religion. I got baptized with a dip in the water. I tried every yogi, tried so many kinds of every kind of yoga, just because I was instructed, find something better. I really wanted to find something better. So that is why I went through all these experiences to see where are we coming to. All kinds of yoga, Kundalini Yoga. I studied all the old texts of the yogas, all 84 postures, all bending of the body, everything I did. And I find that people are totally misunderstanding all the yoga, taking it ordinary exercise. People think the yoga great exercise. It was meant to be exercise for yogis who were doing constant meditation for long periods in caves that had dug out, in quiet places, dark places. And since the place was small, they designed exercises. They couldn't go jogging there. Therefore, they designed exercises, which if you do all the asanas, you get every body, every muscle exercised. So that was the purpose. We are making it totally different use. Books are written on yoga, which means something so different. It's not a yoga. Exercise don't give you spirituality. It is meditation inside that can make you see something inside. So this, after trying everything, I found that the ultimate teaching which this master gave was called Surt Shabd Yoga. Now, that word is interesting. Surt means attention. Shabd means sound. Yoga means union with your total self. So Surt Shabd Yoga, it is yoga of listening to the sound within yourself. That's the key of that system. You still use other sounds, like we are now talking. This sound is called in our scriptures as varanatmak, which can be varnan. That means I am using a language. This is also sound. It's a language. All languages are in sound, spoken. This is which can be heard. Our ears can hear this language. Therefore, this is also sound being heard. It's the lowest kind. When our consciousness rises to the astral plane, the sound can still be heard. But the sound changes from spoken words to unspoken words, but a musical sound, like the sound of a bell. That's why the bell sound is considered very important. If you concentrate your attention, if you are able to sit at the third eye center, you'll be able to hear the sound of the self. You can hear many other sounds too, the physical sounds, the blood circulating in us, they also create sounds. The other sounds are there in the body. And when you are very attentive, you hear many sounds. Actually, there was a Japanese meditator I met at a conference. And he said he had built a soundproof glass chamber in his ashram in Japan, where there is no sound. So he can hear in complete silence, because he said, you have to be completely silent to get enlightened. Some people say that you can eat grain of rice and get enlightened. He said, to be completely silent, you get enlightened. I have never found anybody experiencing complete silence. So I took up the challenge. I said, I'll come to your Tokyo place. And I went to his ashram, about 40 miles outside of Tokyo. And he had built a glass dome and made it soundproof. And even the breathing for the air was rushed at such a low level that the sound was almost not audible. So I said, I like to sit in that chamber and see complete stillness, no sound. When I sat in that chamber, I could hear my heart beat so loudly. I could hear my breathing so loudly. The whole body functions I could hear so easily. There's no place which completes stillness or silence at all. So even when you confine yourself to that space, there is still something, a sound. Sound is playing a very important role, but the most important role is that in the physical plane, in the physical body, it can be heard inside, your own self can be heard. Since we are trying to find our own self, who we are, the sound pulls us towards our own self. And the fastest way of withdrawing your attention from the body, having the near-death experience or dying while living experience, fastest way is not by listening to the repetition of the sound, but by listening to the sound of the self inside. In the beginning, it looks like the sound of a bell, because the bell has a sine curve, dong, dong, like that. That sound doesn't have a dong in it, it's the rest of it, dong, more of the echo of it. That sound is very pulling. It pulls your attention almost, if you hear it quickly, it can almost make you feel you're dying. It can pull your consciousness to the center so fast. Later on, the peal of it becomes longer and longer. It almost becomes like a continuous peal. And in description, they try to describe first as sound of a bell, sound of a conch, which is a continuous, then other sounds. When you go from this level to the next level, the sound is not spoken. You can communicate with others without speaking, but by thinking. Now we say we think in language, in spoken language. We don't. Spoken language comes after our thought. We want to say something, then we find the words for it. We have placed the wrong order, that thoughts are straight away into words. We have a thought which we want to think about, then the words come later. People who have experience of what they call telepathic communication, even here, a person thinks of something in English, in Germany, the friend can hear it and know what it is in German. Where is the translation taking place? The translation is not needed, because what was said to be conveyed and is made into English here, same is conveyed and made into German. That's telepathic, even here. Same method is used in the astral plane continuously for communication. It's telepathic communication, and therefore the sound there is just a musical background. It becomes what we call from varanatmak sound shabd to dhonatmak. Dhon is a continuous sound. It becomes a continuous sound. When it reaches the causal plane, it becomes a very different experience of sound. The sound looks like you have been listening to it all the time. The moment you enter, it doesn't look like now you're listening. You discover you are always listening to it. How come you didn't know it? It's a very different experience. The name of the sound is changed then from dhunatmak shabd to anhad shabd. Anhad means no boundaries. And that's the actual experience. It's not merely a name. It is that which comes. When you cross into the spiritual regions, now there's no time or space like we know, ordinary sound cannot be heard. Therefore, the first time you discover that the sound was yourself. And therefore it's called in the literature Sar Shabd. Sar means real. There's a real Shabd of your own soul. And when you go to the top, the sound is merely was a message from our totality at every level. It's a connecting every level of consciousness. One thing that's connecting is this sound. That is why the sound has been described as God Himself. So there are so many definitions. You can see God in everything, God in everybody, and you can see God and merge in God and be one. And that's the best way to experience. Thank you very much for spending time with me again. And I'll see you at 11 o'clock tomorrow again. Thank you. I'll meet some people who have asked for personal time.